Thank you very much for this opportunity to be with you. I'm very honored. I would like to share with you a few ideas about education, innovation, technology. Basically, social entrepreneurship is a word that today captures where many of the innovations can be. So I will make a short presentation right now, and later I will be available if anybody is interested in going deeper into some of the topics. But before everything, I would like to thank you for having me here. Basically, I would like to propose the power of looking at one same reality from a different perspective. A fruit vendor, like this woman in my country, has been around, 4,000 years? There have always been fruit vendors. But 40 years ago, she was renamed. And with that renaming came a profound change throughout the world. 40 years ago, this vendor was rebaptized as a micro enterprise. And with that definition, her reality and her potential was completely changed. Because as a street vendor, she was basically nothing. But as a micro entrepreneur, she was capable of receiving a loan, of opening a savings account, of being able to have a micro insurance. And the world today has changed because there are more than 250 million women like this who, by the sheer and the just the changing of who she is and what is her potential, her capacity to increase her family income, to strengthen her precarious jobs, and to create new jobs was discovered. Today, as you know, there was an article in The Economist just a few days ago where it says a phone full of money. Because today, thanks to this redefinition, we can pay workers and we can provide loans through text messages and basically the phone system. So what can we learn about the renaming of this person from a street vendor to a micro entrepreneur in education? I would like to share something with you. This is basically the people who are poor in my country and maybe in some of the countries of some of the participants. Or living in very poor areas like this, with schools like this, how can we transform this typical school in developing countries into something different? What I would like to propose is just one example. I'm not saying that this is the future. I'm just saying one example of what can be done. What we have done is we have taken, what did we learn from microfinance? We have learned from microfinance that microfinance works not because of finance, but because of dignity. Because by renaming that lady, you are not only a fruit street vendor, but a micro entrepreneur. We are giving her dignity. And she will respond with dignity. What would happen if we did that with education? And what we are doing is, how can we make this classroom make money in a poor country? So what we do is, we have transformed our schools, some of our schools, of course, where you in classroom learn the theory, but you also take in very, very poor students from the countryside and teach them practical experiences and a practical curriculum on campus. So you have theory and you have practice on campus. But this practice on campus is different from traditional practice on campus because this practice generates money. For the same effort, you can have theory and practice, but this practice be of a sufficient magnitude and volume to generate income and learn everything you need to do in the school campus and have the professors be coaches of what is needed to become employable and use alternative energies to have the student cafeteria have power and have the students learn to sell to the public what they produce on the school campus, where you do get the people skills. So you learn to be, learn to live together, learn to learn, learn to do, but you can also, for the same effort and the same budget, learn to be an entrepreneur and learn to make money in the school. For some reason, in my country, the Ministry of Education does not know how to incorporate entrepreneurship and making money in the curriculum. That is a mysterious skill that should be learned after school. What we are proposing is to incorporate those skills in school in a very protected environment where it is something fun to do. And so basically, what we have is this value proposition. For underprivileged adolescent girls and boys who are chronically and structurally unemployed, our financially self-sufficient school model is an innovative methodology which offers 100% employability to its graduates through a 100% market-based curriculum covering 100% of its budget, including depreciation. This is something that we are doing to challenge ourselves and how we see education. Is employability our objective? Is education expensive? And is quality education even more expensive? How do we pay for quality education in poor countries? Can we think of education in a new way? So basically, give a man a fish and he'll eat for a day, and teach him how to fish and he'll eat for a lifetime. So the schools that we have receive no government funding, are not supported by church or charity, does not rely on charging fees, but relies on income generated 17 small-scale micro enterprises on campus. We know that the problem of education is not only lack of relevancy, but also lack of funding. And so basically, what we are proposing is combining agriculture and business skills with school-owned enterprises that, to generate 100% of the costs. In our schools, we have zero dropout. So basically, what we do is find out what does the Ministry of Education require from its curriculum? What are the learning outcomes that the Ministry of Education does require? And we frame those educational outcomes in fun, practical training combined with classroom, and have the school not only teach how yogurt and cheese are made in the chemistry classroom, but actually produce cheese and yogurt in the school and sell the yogurt. And with that enough yogurt sold, you can cover the salary of the professor. So basically, what do you need? Identify the competencies needed, determine the type and size of the school enterprises, analyze the market for the goods and services to be produced, analyze the school's productive capacity, develop a business plan, implement work plans and investment plan, and integrate the curriculum with the practical training. This looks foreign, but it is actually easy and fun. So basically, you have a paradigm shift in financial sustainability, operational sustainability, programmatic sustainability, and environmental sustainability. And you have an innovation revolution, you have a widespread movement, and you have a dissemination strategy. And this is where we are now working, promoting financially self-sufficient schools. And if it is a very big enterprise to acquire, we're starting with business clubs on school campus that basically achieve the same objectives. We now have 50 organizations in 15 countries that are replicating the full model, and some 2,500 members in 150 countries that are practicing one way or another to promote this thing. You can find it in the website of our teachamantofish.org.uk, more information on this. And this is the very, very poor boys and girls who graduate from our schools. But so basically, what we're asking, we're taking this educational, we're taking what the microfinance experience, what did microfinance do, and applying it to education. And now we're saying, what can education do to end poverty? And I will share with you very briefly the evolution of this line of thinking. So using why doesn't she have teeth? And we are saying, why are people poor? Why don't they have water? Why don't they have education? Is it their behavior? Is it the system where they live, both of which are external to the person? Or are these internal things? Is it the culture? Or is it her intention? Because if it is her behavior, we're going to start working on changing the way people act. Is it that she doesn't brush her teeth? Or is it that there are no dental clinics for her to go? Raise your hands, who thinks it's behavior? Raise your hands, who thinks it's the system? Okay. Raise your hands, who thinks it's culture? Or raise your hands, who thinks it could be her personal intention? She may be afraid of going to the dentist. So, are poor people empty vessels that we need to fill? Or do the poor have everything they need inside, and we just need to unleash trapped energy and trapped wealth? Again, raise your hands. Who thinks that the poor are empty vessels that need to be filled? Or who thinks that the poor have trapped energy and wealth that must be released? With this thinking, we're saying these are the two paradigms of poverty in the world. We are either going to reduce poverty or we are going to alleviate poverty. We're going to reduce poverty with productive investment, make the economy grow, have the ocean go so big boats and small and smaller boats all rise. Or if this doesn't work, let's alleviate poverty by providing help to the poor. And of course, what is the elephant in the living room in this strategy? What is the big problem of all the poverty strategies? The poor are not invited to the debate. Why? Most likely because, or we believe that they have nothing to offer, or we do not know how to invite 1.5 billion people to the discussion. So what we are proposing is not talk about poverty alleviation or poverty reduction anymore, but talk about poverty elimination, bring the poor to the center of the debate, and produce a great alliance in society. But can we rescue the positive role of the poor family in this debate? This conference is about technology and education. With technology, we can do great things. Basically, one of the things is everything in poverty has to do with indexes, right? The Human Development Index. Health, education, life expectancy divided by 3, you have a number. Or you can do the multidimensional poverty index, and you can add 10 indicators, but you have a number. Why do we use indexes in the debate of poverty? Because indexes are for policymakers. Are indexes for the poor people themselves? If you are the head of a poor household, would you mind being a 5.7 or a 7.5? Does that mean anything? With technology, we can change the center of gravity and say, let's say that we not need to work with a corn cob, but what if dealing with the kernels was easier and possible thanks to technology? So basically, what is poverty? It's, of course, not only income. It is multidimensional. There's self-awareness, there's environment, there's health, there's education. So we have 6 dimensions, and we have operationalized these 6 dimensions into 50 indicators, working with very poor heads of households in different countries, and also with students. We are asking students to spearhead the elimination of strategy around the world. Is that possible? Today, with technology, it is. Basically, we're using telephones and tablets to make visual surveys. Don't ask the poor, how big is your house? Do you have bedrooms? Do you have beds? Do you have a latrine? Do you have water? But basically, for each indicator, show them 3 photographs and have them select the photograph that represents them. In 20 minutes, you can have a self-diagnose. For example, what kind of water do you have? This is a visual survey for my country. It varies from country to country. But basically, is there a faucet in the house? Is there a well? Or do you bring water from the river? In 1 second, the family can select the photos. And in 20 minutes, you can have a full diagnosis by the family, for the family, the first time that anybody has asked, who are you? Are you poor? How? And basically, every family has a dashboard of 50 indicators that she says, I am red, I am yellow, or I am green in this indicator. And this dashboard becomes a plan to overcome poverty by that family, for that family. And basically what we're doing, I don't know if we have time, but I can show you on the panel in the meeting later. Basically what we're doing is we're taking this information and we're geo-referencing in Google Maps. This is a village in my country of houses lined up in a rural road. And to the question, do you feel you live in a safe, unsafe, or very unsafe house? You will have people in the same village responding red, yellow, or green. The same thing goes for, have you eaten well in the past week? Do you generate income above the poverty line? Do you have the skills necessary to generate income? And so basically, what we can do today for each family, apply what Albert Bandura from Stanford University writes about in self-efficacy and agency. For people to change, they need to answer two questions. Is it worth it? And can I do it? Is it worth it has to do with motivation. Can I do it has to do with skills and learning to do what is not fun, personal motivation. Acquiring skills and surpassing personal limitations, those are skills. Peer pressure, group support, incentives, prizes, and awards, and physical changes in the environment. So basically what you can have is develop a baseline, bring in the poor families to say, are you poor in what? Because you can be poor in income, but have okay teeth, have okay house, have a bad latrine, and the next door neighbor may have a problem with income, good teeth, good latrine, good bathroom, bad self-esteem. And this allows technology for the poor people to be invited to the debate and develop their own strategy to overcome poverty. We are now working with partners in 18 countries. We just launched it in Cape Town a couple of weeks ago, the South African version, of what does it mean, in the case of Nigeria, to be poor in Nigeria? Anybody from Nigeria here? What does it mean to be poor in Adamawa State? Talking to the Fulani in Adamawa. It is very different from South America, but they do know what it is not to be poor, what it is to be poor, and what it is to be very poor in that country. And once you have a definition of poverty by the poor, for the poor, it is easier for the families to overcome poverty. And so how do you move from that latrine to this bathroom in a South American country? Or how do you move from a lady that only sells 30 tortillas a day to sell 300 tortillas a day? How do you do it? And how do you move that girl living in abject poverty to graduate from high school, or that boy to become an agronomist in the university? So basically, in conclusion, what I think can be a useful exercise is look at education from a new perspective. What, we're talking about creative destruction. What has happened in microfinance? Can we come up with a same revolution in education? It's not about the money. It's not about the market economy. It's looking at the same thing from a different perspective. And I have shared with you what we are doing going from microfinance to education. We have developed a model of education that can pay for itself. And now with that same concept, we are now finding how people can eliminate poverty. I thank you very, very much for your attention and for having me with you here today. Thank you.